Well, let's get more insight from our security correspondent Frank Gardner and from John Hemmings, director of the Asia Studies Center at the Henry Jackson Society. And John, let me ask you first. It's almost we've tried everything. The international community has tried everything. Do you feel there is anything significant that can be done to exert more meaningful pressure on North Korea?
Yes, I do. I don't think everything has been done. I think everything's been done at the UN Security Council level. We've crossed all the T's, dotted all the I's that the Chinese have wanted us to. Where the problem is at the border. When you have coal shipments and you have Chinese aid crossing the border, that's not on the books. And we've seen really the uptick in the crisis is how Xi Jinping will react to this pressure that is now being focused squarely on him.
Frank, what about the Chinese and intelligence? I mean, we don't know whether they knew this was coming or how much they could help in intel terms.
They could certainly help more than they have been so far. Whether it's in their interests is something that's still probably being worked out in Beijing. North Korea is an incredibly difficult intelligence target. So this has been an intelligence failure for the West. Let's not beat around the bush. It's a failure. Nobody in Washington and London predicted the speed of advance of North Korea towards full intercontinental ballistic nuclear capability. It's gone far faster than they expected, and people are shocked. The magnitude of the explosions are bigger than people thought they would be able to achieve at this stage. Now, there's an open question about whether they've had help from the Chinese or not with this. The one country that really has good optics, good vision on what's going on inside North Korea is China. Does China actually want to help the United States in this? Up until now, probably not, because remember that they are already in a potential conflict over the South China Sea. China has essentially colonized a number of artificial islands in the South China Sea in what is claimed to be international waters. China says it's theirs. The United States is insisting on the right of putting its warships through there. So there is a conflict in the making there. So China is going to be very, very circumspect about what it shares with the United States, quite apart from the fact it does not want to see the US come out on top in any kind of conflict. It doesn't want conflict in the Korean Peninsula, but it doesn't want to help the United States.
John, first, what China is saying today, the foreign ministry spokesperson said, you know, it's not objective and it's not fair, in their words, this criticism. Beijing is not being given the credit it deserves for trying to deal with this issue.
Well, I mean, at the risk of sounding trite, they would say that, wouldn't they? I mean, we have looked at, you know, launch erector trucks that carry nuclear weapons go through the parades in Pyongyang that were built in China. We saw, you know, a huge building spree that has taken place across Pyongyang, the arrival of appliances, a whole type of kind of luxury lifestyle for the elites. Yes, people are still starving in the countryside, but they tend to be the wavering or disloyal classes. So we've seen a regime that's heavily subsidized by the Chinese. And I do agree with Frank that it is making the Chinese pay a price for the support, the subsidies. And of course, there are geopolitical considerations, but we saw what a sharp reaction the sanctioning of Dandong Bank, you know, that was a very small step that the Trump administration showed, I think, for the first time, a willingness that previous American presidents haven't been willing to do, which is to put the US-China economic relationship on the table. So he has the economic relationship on the table and he has military forces in the region. And I think both will be used to apply pressure and get the Chinese to do the right thing.
Well, on that angle of military forces and the assets in the region, I know you see that in Seoul they are saying, we want more help.
Yes, I mean, the issues here is the thing called THAAD, which is this terminal high-altitude aerial defense. In other words, a missile that can shoot down other missiles, or at least that's what it's expected to do. China is very opposed to this because the radar attached to this device can see inside China. So China doesn't like this at all. And there was a really interesting proposal put forward by Robert Gates, the former head of the CIA, former US Defense Secretary, earlier this year. It was a theological proposal put forward that here was an offer that the Chinese might find hard to refuse. Deal with North Korea or accept that the alternative is a lot of these THAAD missile defenses, which you're not going to like, all around Northeast Asia. Unfortunately, the whole situation has now run away with world leaders. that actually that choice is probably taken out of their hands now. It's moving too fast. And where there are some people who thought, well, let's just let it play, it's got to a really dangerous stage right now.
Could it get more dangerous in the sense, John, I note that US nuclear devices were withdrawn from South Korea, I think back in 1991. But there is some opinion in the South that, well, look, we need to meet the potential threat with potential threat.
This is a really difficult topic. I'm not myself adverse to the idea of the reintroduction of tactical weapons if it stabilizes the situation. We have to remember the entire Cold War, they were there. And there was a sort of nuclear, understood nuclear umbrella by the Soviet side, as well as by the US ROC, Republic of Korea side. But I think it's a debate for the South Koreans. It's a debate for the US-South Korea alliance. It's not really something that can be decided quickly because it's very difficult to undo once you've let that cat back out of the bag.
Sure. John Hemmings, Frank Gardner, thank you both very much.
Thank you.